What you gonna do with that dessert? Do what do I need that?
Hi, I'm Greg, professional power hunter, and this is Power Up, the only show where we go hunting for power all over the globe. So come alongside me, my cameraman Dan, as we go on the hunt for power. Let's power up, let's go. Remote construction site. On today's episode, I, Greg, am gonna produce energy. I know what you're thinking, Greg, how are you gonna do that? You're not Pikachu. You can't produce electricity out of a tail. I know that, but here's the deal. Pikachu is a rodent. What do rodents do? They run on hamster wheels. So today, we are gonna find ourselves a hamster wheel. Let's go, Dan. Oh, we got it, a traditional hamster wheel. Now, it took us a while to get. After going to a few pet stores, we found one. So, now we're gonna transfer energy from this hamster wheel to that light bulb using kinetic energy. Kinetic energy pretty much means transferring energy using motion. How are we gonna get the motion? By running on the hamster wheel. So, we got our power up official wires right there. Hooked up, everything's ready to roll. Now the last thing left, harnessing our inner hamster right here. So we're gonna start running on there like a hamster would. There we go. And as you can see, look at that. We got some flickers, but we need a bigger hamster here. So we gotta roll as fast as we can, but it might not be strong enough. Dan, we're losing power, and it's out. Dan, I thought the hamster wheel was gonna work. We were very, very close, but we gotta go back to the drawing board. We need to figure out how to create kinetic energy by using motion. I'm going to the think chair. Dan, Let's go. So we're in the think chair right now, and we've been studying hamsters a lot. We learned that a hamster can power a light bulb all on its own using kinetic energy. But like we learned from my experiment, I couldn't even turn a light bulb on using my strength. Sometimes I'm just not strong enough, and life feels like a hamster wheel. But here's the deal. There's only one thing that you can do, and that's turn to God's power. We know that there were a lot of people in the Bible that turned to God during tough times, and one of those guys was named Peter. He was one of Jesus's disciples, and he told many people about Jesus. Peter was eventually arrested by King Herod and put in prison. The night before Peter was supposed to go on trial, God sent one of his angels to help him. The angel busted Peter out of the prison, and then Peter continued to tell others about the good news of Jesus. The Holy Spirit totally helped Peter out and gave him the strength he needed to carry out Jesus's mission. Following God's plan for his life was no easy thing for Peter, but the Holy Spirit gave him the power he needed to get through it. Just like Peter, God has put a calling on your lives too. Sometimes we may find ourselves in similar situations. Okay, maybe not in prison, but we may feel confused about what God's asked us to do. The cool thing is, the power of the Holy Spirit will help us understand the plan that He has for our lives. God's word tells us that God has our backs, that we can always rely on the power of the Holy Spirit to help us. If you want to know what God has planned for you, I would encourage you to read His word and talk to Him. Ask Him to use the Holy Spirit to show you His plan for you. So many times, God's plan is so much bigger. Bigger. Dan, we need a bigger hamster wheel.
So we had to go bigger, and it seems to be working. We have to flip our kinetic energy switch. Boom! Here we go! The kinetic energy is transferring. Not now, Dan. Don't ask about the Pikachu suit. And it's moving. The energy is transferring. Yes, the kinetic energy is working. We almost have a full-size Santa Claus. Dan, we did it. Using kinetic energy and the power of motion, we just blew up a life-size Santa Claus. That does it for us on Power Up. And remember, with using the Holy Spirit, you can do more than you could ever imagine. I'm Greg. We'll see you Power Uppers on the hunt for power. Let's go, Dan. That's too steep. We gotta go around.
true kindness is being nice to other people, even if they can't pay you back. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas, and today we're going to be talking about kindness. Yeah, kindness is a fruit of the Spirit. Yeah, and the fruit of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And yeah, so we're talking about kindness today, and kindness is pretty much just being nice to people. But it's more than that. It's being nice to everyone, even if they can't pay you back for it. And here's kind of what I mean by that. So I've got this friend at school. Well, I call him my lunch friend. He's not really like my friend. He's my lunch friend. And his name is Justin. And I call him my lunch friend because, well, at lunch, he comes over and he sits down and we hang out and he tells jokes and he laughs at my jokes and he says nice things to me. And you know, he's a really good friend. But not even every day at lunch is he a good friend. Sometimes at lunch, he doesn't even come talk to me. And a lot of times, mostly at school, if we're not in the lunchroom, he's not talking to me at all. And I could not understand why he was only my friend on certain lunch days. And then finally, I realized he's only my friend on cookie day. Yeah, so my mom, she makes these delicious cookies, okay? And sometimes she'll send me a couple cookies in my lunchbox. And on cookie day, Justin will come over and he'll hang out with me and he'll, you know, be friends with me and he'll be a really nice guy. And then he'll always, somehow in the conversation, he'll trade me something for one of my cookies. So Justin is only my friend so that he can get a cookie. Now, don't get me wrong, these are delicious cookies. But that's not cool. That's not a real friend. God wants us to be nice to everyone, even if they can't pay us back. And so I thought, well, he's not really my friend, so I'm not going to give him any more cookies. Because I thought I wasn't going to be his friend unless he was going to be my friend. God loves everyone. And if we love God, then we'll love everyone too. Because God does. That's what God wants for us. He says, love God and love other people. That's what we're supposed to do. Show kindness to everyone. Not because we want something from them, but because God loves them. And we should too. So if I say I'm only going to give my friendship to someone who gives their friendship to me, how am I any better than Justin? You know, he was my friend. He was saying nice things and he was hanging out with me and spending time with me and all that stuff just to get a cookie. And sometimes I think I'm only friends with people so that they will be friends with me because I want a friend. And man, though, it can be really hard to be nice to people who aren't nice to you in return. But if you are a Christian, if you have the Holy Spirit living inside you and you are living according to the Spirit, then you will be kind. Even the people who call themselves your enemy. So I decided that I'm still going to give Justin cookies. Yeah. If he comes over and he sits down next to me and he wants to talk because he wants cookies, I'm going to give him cookies. And maybe I might just give a cookie to him next time instead of trading him for something that he's got. So my challenge to you guys is this. I want you to think about all the different people that you see in your daily life. You know, whether you see people at school or at home or at church or just, you know, out doing errands with your mom and dad or wherever you are and whatever people you meet, I want you to think about each individual person. That might be kind of hard. There might be a lot of people, but I want you to really, really sit down and think about the different people that you see in your life. And I want you to ask yourself if you are being kind to them. And if the answer is no, then you definitely need to work on that. You should be kind to everyone. And if the answer is yes, you are being kind to them, I want you to ask yourself another question. I want you to ask yourself, why? Why are you being kind to them? Because if your answer is, I'm nice to them because they're nice to me, or you say, I'm nice to them because my mom says I have to be, then I think it's time to check your heart, to check and see if you are spending enough time with God and if you're living the way God wants you to. Because one of the best ways to tell if an apple tree is an apple tree is to see if it's got apples on it. And so if you want to be able to tell if you are living according to the Spirit of God, see if you're being kind to people. And if you're not, or you are being kind to people just so you get something from them, then you need to spend more time with God. God loves everyone, and God wants us to show everyone love too. God wants us to show His kindness to everyone that we meet. Even if they're mean to us, God wants us to show kindness to them. And yeah, that is very difficult. But the Holy Spirit living inside you, if you are a Christian, the Holy Spirit is living inside you. God lives in you. You are God's temple. And God can help you to be kind. So let's all work really hard to show God's kindness to everyone, even if they can't pay us back.
Oh yeah, you know what time it is. It's time to learn the book. 1, 2, 3.
These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible.
Yo, it's the Old Testament.
Here we go, here we go. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, just to name a few. We got Numbers. Then a story about a girl named Ruth. First and second Samuel. First and second Kings. First and second Chronicles. We're talking about history.
There were a couple of guys who were up to some good.
We got Ezra, Nehemiah. They helped build a wall around the neighborhood. We got Esther, Job, and Psalms.
These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible.
And then we got the books of wisdom.
We got Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, the Song of Solomon. He was a wise king.
Then we're moving right along to the majors.
Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel.
Daniel got thrown in the lion's den.
But he wasn't alone.
God was with him.
And then we got the minor prophets.
Hosea, Jonah, and Amos, Obadiah.
Jonah got swallowed by a big fish on his way to Tarshish. And then we got Micah.
You. Let's close it down with Revelation.
These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible. These are the books of the Bible. When we read them, it makes us stronger. And we learn about our Heavenly Father. When we read all the books of the Bible.
God's story, Joseph. So part of God's story is about a guy named Joseph, and it begins like this. Once there was a guy named Joseph who had 10 older brothers and one younger one. When Joe was a boy, he was his dad's favorite. In fact, his dad liked him so much better than his brothers that he gave Joe a special gift to prove it. You can imagine this made his brothers jealous. And Joe only made things worse. He told his brothers about dreams he had where he was ruling over them. Well, this made Joe's brothers furious. One day they were working and saw Joe coming. They said, "Here comes that dreamer." They threw Joe into a dark pit. They might have left him there forever, but they met some men traveling from Egypt and sold Joe to them as a servant instead. They thought that was slightly nicer than leaving him in a pit. Then they went home and told their father Joe had been killed by a wild animal. This broke their dad's heart. Kids, these brothers were really bad news. Selling a sibling is never a good idea. Ever. But the Bible says the Lord was with Joe. When Joe was a servant, he worked for a really important rich guy named Potiphar. And Potiphar liked Joe so much, he put him in charge of the whole house. Joe was happy until one day he was blamed for something he didn't do, and Potiphar sent him straight to jail. Well, God was still with Joe, even in prison. The guard decided he liked Joe so much, he put him in charge of all the other prisoners. Then God gave Joe special knowledge about dreams. When two prisoners had dreams, Joe knew what they meant, so he told them. 2 years later, Egypt's ruler called Pharaoh had a dream, and nobody knew what it meant. But by now, one of the two prisoners Joe had helped was out of jail and working for Pharaoh. He told Pharaoh about Joe, and God helped Joe figure out what Pharaoh's dream meant. But Pharaoh's dream was really more of a nightmare. It meant that everybody in Egypt would have food for 7 years, then be hungry for 7 years. Joe told Pharaoh the only way to survive was to store food during the 7 good years. Well, Pharaoh thought Joe's idea was brilliant. He put him in charge. During the 7 hungry years, nobody could eat without getting food from Joe. He was like a human vending machine. Well, remember how Joe had 11 brothers? Like everybody else, they had to get food from Joe. And when they came, they didn't even recognize their brother. But Joe knew who they were. He secretly tested them to see if they changed. After all, they did throw him in a pit and sell him. Finally, he couldn't hide who he was from his brothers anymore. He told everyone to leave the room because he was about to cry. After sobbing for a few minutes, he told them, "I'm your brother Joseph. I'm the one you sold." The brothers couldn't believe it. They had hurt Joe, but God had taken care of him during the good times and the bad. Even with everything they had done to Joe, he forgave them because he was willing to follow God, even when it was hard. Joe told them, "You planned to harm me, but God planned it for good." And God used Joe to save many lives, including the family that was part of God's special rescue plan. And that's the story of Joseph. So in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Joe was his dad's favorite. His brother sold him. Potiphar put Joe in charge. Joe was sent to jail. The guard put Joe in charge. Pharaoh had a bad dream. Joe told him what it meant. Pharaoh put Joe in charge. Joe's brothers had to come to him for food. Joe forgave them. This was part of God's rescue plan. And that's a part of God's story.
God. to something good. I know that you are always up to something good. You'll make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good.
That you've given to me, and I just gotta praise.